Hello, everyone, and welcome. This is the first episode of our Innovation Today GenAI Perspectives video series. I am incredibly excited to host this series today. For those who don't know me, I am Erica Volini, Senior Vice President of Global Partnerships here at ServiceNow, and I am thrilled to have a special guest with me today, KK Dave, who is a principal at Deloitte. KK, welcome, and thank you for joining us today.
Thank you, Erica. It is a pleasure to be with you.
So let's start. It would be great to give some context to our audience and to our listeners, what your role is and why that gives you a good vantage point to talk about this huge topic of GenAI.
Absolutely. I'm a principal with Deloitte, and I lead our commercial ServiceNow business in the U.S. within our enterprise performance portfolio. Now, this topic, as you can imagine, is super important and relevant as our clients are looking for productivity gains with the intent of freeing up resources to take on higher value activities. Plus, it's also the absolute right time because of how GenAI capabilities have matured in the recent past, and our clients are eager to take advantage of them.
No doubt. The business case is so strong, and it does feel like it's really the next evolution of digital transformation, this journey that I know you and I know we've been part of for, it feels like, many, many decades. And we're still trying to get that elusive goal of optimal productivity for the workforce. And GenAI seems primed to be able to deliver that, but everyone is using the term GenAI, and I think everyone's using it differently. So why don't we start with your definition? How would you define what GenAI is?
Well, first of all, certainly generative AI is the most impactful evolution in the world of artificial intelligence at the moment. And it is impactful enough that GenAI is considered not just about technology anymore, but about a fundamental shift in business strategy. Now, with all the advancements we are seeing in GenAI, there are capabilities that can generate text, images, or other media in response to human prompts, all using natural language. Right, that's kind of the mind-blowing thing about this. And this ability for machines to understand and process human language to execute complex tasks is how I define GenAI. We've never seen anything like this before, and certainly not at this scale.
I agree with you completely. And I love that definition about the human language component of it, because that's what really makes it accessible to everyone. I mean, even my mom is using GenAI for everything she does. And I think the reality is it's now so accessible that it feels like it's possible to include it in every part of your business, every corner, every process that you're executing. But I actually think that's also what makes it incredibly overwhelming for organizations. Where do you start? Because it feels like GenAI can impact almost everything that any organization does. So you're out there in the market, Deloitte's out there in the market, advising clients on how to begin their GenAI journey. What do you tell them about how to get started?
Well, first of all, I think, you know, the lens here is that you want to look at how do you utilize these capabilities to enable the workforce to complete their work in a more efficient manner, right? The goal here is to reduce low-value, repetitive tasks and then free up time for more high-value-add work that the employees can be focused on. Now, every day, the number of business applications are growing, and they're growing exponentially. And we are also starting to see savings that are quite material in the business world. Now, if you look at, you know, most organizations are running processes that are core to their business. And as you well know, many of these are enabled by business platforms, many ERPs, other enterprise applications. But when you dig deeper, what you will see is that most of these processes still have a lot of manual steps in them. Like, for example, you can create a master data, but the process to gain approvals and inputs from multiple users is still being handled via emails or by some kind of manual interaction, right? Now, with GenAI, you can actually automate the process end-to-end, compile the required information, and then use ServiceNow's workflow technology to route the work to the users, right? Saving precious time. Now, none of this was possible earlier. So the way I see it, you now have the capability to arm users with GenAI-based productivity tools, and that's where I would start. Like, bring the power to the end users, involve them in building a roadmap, that aligns with their organization's overall vision and help them unlock the business value.
KK, that was a lot of great information. So I want to summarize for our listeners. Here's what I heard. Number one, let's start by focusing on where the heavy manual work is still in these processes. And it's hard to believe that after decades of doing digital transformation, there's still manual work, but you and I both know there is. So let's focus there. And that's a great place to start because that's going to make the biggest difference in the experience for the employees to be able to get them on board. Second, another great way to get them on board is to involve them in the process. And I think your point around the fact that this is really works in natural language gives everyone the ability to interact with this technology, which is an incredible way to drive adoption because it allows the employees to be part of the process. And the third thing I heard from you is this still is ultimately about unlocking human potential. And that is something I'm personally passionate about, but I think it's so important, which is GenAI is not a replacement of what humans do with technology. It is simplifying what humans do, taking out the work where there isn't that value add contribution to allow humans to really leverage their full capabilities, unlock their potential, and get to that more strategic nature of the work, which I think is an incredible opportunity for the workforce and is really what drives that productivity. Did I get those points right? Anything else you would add on to that?
No, you absolutely got them right. I mean, I think the only thing I would add is you've got so many use cases that can be piloted right away, right? And to my point, users can actually touch and feel it from day one, and that allows them to build upon it, and that gives them more ideas as to where the manual work may be and bring all that down. So I think that's exactly the way I see it.
Let's talk about use cases for a second, because ultimately this all comes down to organizations creating a competitive advantage for themselves. What are the use cases you've seen? You said you've seen many of them. What are the ones that you have already proven out to really add value from your perspective?
Absolutely. Look, there's so many of them, but I picked a couple that I wanted to share with you and our users here. First, I want to start with a use case that may not be well known, which is around building applications within the information technology realm, if you will. So now it is possible to take a transcript from a user requirement meeting and translate that into user stories for a developer to code. And then if you're building these applications on the ServiceNow platform, the developer can actually use text to code these applications and then run it through an automated testing and deliver an application in a matter of hours versus what used to take days, if not weeks, right? To me, that's so powerful.
I mean, that blows my mind. And with the developer shortage that so many companies are facing, that feels like a game changer in terms of competitive advantage, being able to really do more with fewer developers. And I assume the quality also increases.
It does, because you're actually not leaving anything to human error. You're automating the testing component as well. And by the way, you can run those testing as many times as you want till you get perfect in whatever application is being developed. So I think there is a huge advantage in applying that to our businesses right away. The other example that I want to talk about is it's more within the, you know, in the area of application maintenance. So you have, you know, many a times you have systems that have defects or systems that, you know, sometimes have problems. Now, generative AI can understand the context of where a user could be having a problem. And then based on historical instructions and some knowledge-based articles, it can suggest the resolution in real time, right? And essentially, all of this will allow us to move towards a self-healing process in an organization.
I love that term, self-healing. And it really, I mean, it ultimately comes down to the customer experience, right? This is how we're going to move the needle on customer experience, because you're essentially understanding sentiment, how an individual is feeling, what they're going through, using trend data to then recommend to them what the next best action is. So to alleviate their frustration, to make the process easier, to make the experience better. Did I get that right?
Yeah, absolutely did.
And I assume this can apply in any industry context. Are there certain industries that you're seeing being more early adopters of GenAI, or do you see this truly cross-industry?
I do see it cross-industry. One of the more popular use cases that we see is around virtual agents, right? And now deploying virtual agents whether it is to drive, you know, self-service user experience within the four walls of an organization, but also similar to that, also applying it to external customers, you know, to answer queries that would otherwise need a human to research and look at things of status of invoices, purchase orders, etc. So that particular use case around a virtual agent is something that I think is pretty universal. Now, you know, imagine this, right? Your customers could be calling your call center to either inquire about details of a bill or log an issue about an equipment not working, etc. And in most organizations, answers to these questions lie with different departments that requires a lot of coordination. Now, with GenAI, you can provide an immediate answer or an immediate response, or at least give your clients an ETA on more complex queries and not leave them hanging for days, you know, and cause frustration. So these are real scenarios, and industries like telecom, wholesale distribution, or even a retailer can be applying them right away.
Absolutely. I mean, I think all of us listening here are thinking, yeah, I interact with virtual agents pretty much throughout my day, every single day in one way, shape, or form. And the idea that that experience could be so dramatically improved through this GenAI experience is very appealing. And so it does feel like, again, it would be a huge competitive advantage for organizations. So we add this all up and we think, you know, benefits for employees because it eliminates manual work, benefits for customers because it improves the experience, benefits for organizations because it unlocks productivity. It's hard to understand the downside. And yet I think we can acknowledge that there is hesitation out there. Even CEOs are asking themselves, how do I want to go into this? There's some trepidation. What are the concerns that you're hearing and how do you go about alleviating those concerns?
Well, let me start by saying that, you know, that hesitation is slowly disappearing, if you ask me. And just the time for CEOs to hesitate in embracing GenAI is kind of behind us a little bit, if you will. And I'll tell you, Deloitte does a survey, and one of the survey is called State of AI in the Enterprise. And nearly half of the leaders that responded shared that they have very high degree of expertise when it comes to GenAI. And a majority of them anticipate that GenAI will drive substantial transformations within the next 3 years, right? So these business leaders are recognizing the fact that if they're not adopting GenAI or experimenting with it heavily, they're at the risk of being left behind. But to your point, there is a need for proactive and robust approach to risk and governance, right? Because after all, safeguarding your business and the business interests and your proprietary knowledge is absolutely priority number one. But the good news is there are solutions and approaches that organizations can adopt to alleviate all of those concerns. And all the CEOs and other business leaders are taking note of that.
I think that's great. First of all, it's great to hear that level of optimism has increased. And I think, and maybe it's a sign of the times in terms of how much GenAI is maturing, and it's happened in rapid time, right? From it's a concept, it kind of just appeared to now, and then we had resistance, and now you're saying we're having that adoption and that recognition that we have to be experimenting. Every company needs to be embracing it. So then it gets to proving out its success and measuring it. You've talked a lot about productivity. Is that the key measure that you look at in order to drive that continuous adoption and prove that it's working? Are there other measures that you look at when you develop business cases for your customers experimenting with GenAI?
Well, I mean, productivity is the most tangible value that we can measure with applying generative AI. The other one, of course, is more qualitative around customer satisfaction, or even in some cases, employee satisfaction to be working in these organizations. So to your point, you know, creating a business case, both quantitative and qualitative, is the way to go. We have developed many use cases, like I mentioned earlier, that we can pilot immediately. So people have a way to imagine, well, not just imagine, but actually touch and feel what that impact would look like, which allows them to build a much better business case. And our recommendation, of course, is that our clients take these, you know, all these opportunities that are identified, and then create a business case, track benefits, but do it on an ongoing basis, right? And also continue to identify new opportunities, because that's going to allow them to continue to be on this journey.
I think tracking statistics is so important. And as you know, everything that we build at ServiceNow, we use ourselves. We call it Now on Now. And some of the best statistics I've seen have come from our internal use. we found by putting GenAI in place, we actually saw a 20% reduction in cases, which is pretty significant when it goes back to those productivity savings that you talked about. And then on top of that, we saw that for the cases that did come in, GenAI made it 66% faster in terms of the time to resolve those cases, which is pretty incredible. When you think about that translating into not only productivity gains, but just a better experience for those employees so they could focus on that more strategic work that we were talking about earlier. I'd have to think that those are the types of statistics that you're working with your customers on to build into the business cases to really justify that investment in GenAI.
That's exactly the case, right? And again, it's applied in so many different, parts of the business, right? Whether it's internal, external, IT, business, you can go on and on. And the tangible way of measuring this and the outputs that clients are starting to see is why the confidence is rising to go and adopt more and more of this technology. And I'm sure there are many opinions and viewpoints on where this is all headed. The way I see it is we are not far from the day where we'll need to generate machine stories along with user stories as more and more work is getting automated. And from that standpoint, we'll start to see organizations move from a single threat AI agent towards utilizing AI agents with different roles and different personas that learn to interact with each other to deliver outcomes, right? So for example, imagine a business analyst AI agent working together with a testing AI agent to ensure that the expected user requirement is delivered with appropriate quality. And those kinds of examples are the ones that I see coming fast and furious at us. And that's how I imagine the virtual world interacting with the real world, with agents also learning and getting smarter and delivering business outcomes.
KK, thank you so much. This was an incredible conversation. I love the insights that you shared. I think our listeners are going to really appreciate understanding, first of all, how we define GenAI, that link to this natural language capability that really gives people the ability to use this technology in brand new ways. The fact that it is truly strategic, this is not about replacing humans, this is about enhancing what workers have the ability to do and unlocking that potential. And the fact that you are seeing this incredible optimism from executives in using GenAI and how this is becoming the norm, and then a preview of what's coming for the future, which I just think I am so excited about. I mean, there's a lot to unpack here. There's a lot to be excited about. GenAI, as we all know, it's here to stay. We're at the beginning of this incredible journey, but super excited that ServiceNow is playing an incredible role and that Deloitte is playing a tremendous role in really bringing this front and center to our joint customers. So thank you again for joining us today.
Thank you. It's a pleasure being here.